Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Call our meeting to order and welcome everyone this morning. And at this time, I'd ask Commissioner Byrd if he could do a convocation.
Thank you. In recognition of the wide diversity of faiths that we have in our community, I'd like to have a moment of silence so that each of us can pray in our own way. And as we do that, I'd like to ask you to remember several people. First, Barry Bass, who most of you know, was our director of health, and who unexpectedly passed away about a week and a half ago. His funeral was this past Saturday. So let's remember Barry. I know that he was a friend and colleague of mine, and I know that he was loved and revered by many in this room. I'd like for us to remember why we were here, so that this body can lead and govern our county government as a body and not as individuals. In a manner that is best for all of our citizenry. I'd like to remember the victims of human trafficking, which I've learned a little bit more about this past week, as thanks to Sheriff Johnson and his staff when I visited them and toured the detention center. And those that are suffering from other forms of oppression, enslavement, and abuse. Let's remember those that are homeless and hungry, especially our children. I hear all the time about children coming to our schools that come from family situations that are just not conducive to learning, so let's remember them. Let's remember those that are suffering from mental illness and physical illness and the challenges of aging. And let's remember all the agencies and county departments that are really taking care of all of these different categories of people that I just mentioned. And in the spirit of the law enforcement rally that occurred this past Saturday that many in this room attended, let's remember our law enforcement officers and our uniformed armed services personnel who put themselves in harm's way every day to protect us. So let's have that moment of silence. Amen.
Please stand for a pledge of allegiance. Take a moment.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right, public speakers, I'd like to welcome Mr. Rick Ballman. Come up, please.
Morning.
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 Thank you for hearing me this morning. Again, my name is Rick Ballman. I live on Altima Hall Racetrack Road. I've been a citizen in the county for over 30 years and been a business professional in the county during that time. The reason I'm here is our community around the A Speedway has some concerns about, particularly right now, about the ownership change of the Speedway. There was an article recently in the Times News on December the 24th, 2014, and the new manager and potentially the new owner, Bill Catania, says that he envisions growing Ace as a multi-purpose venue, and he wants to have more strategy behind how to use the track better year-round. This is a concern for our community because of some of the past issues we've already had with the track. I actually appeared here on behalf of our community previously and talked about these issues, and I want to stress that there are many residences in earshot of the Speedway. There are also two churches within 1/8 of a mile of the Speedway and another one within 1/2 a mile of the Speedway. The thing that really brought this thing to a head was a musical concert and a rodeo that occurred on October 13th, 2013. We obtained about over 60 people signing a petition indicating that they wanted something to change related to that concert that occurred on a Sunday, and it lasted from around 3 in the afternoon till about 8:30 at night. The windows in my home were rattling, the windows in other people's homes in the community were rattling, and they were very upset about it. After a presentation to the commissioners previously, the planning and zoning manager then, Jason Martin, required Brad Allen, the Ace Speedway manager, to meet with myself and some other community representatives, and we met and expressed our concerns about the music event on Sunday, and we also expressed some other concerns, including allowing drivers to practice 7 days a week at any time of the day, from early morning until late at night. Also the growth of non-racing related events and the noise with the go-kart track speakers located within 200 yards of many of the residences along the road. One of the go-kart events lasted until 2:30 in the morning on a Saturday night. Mr. Allen said that he had to meet with us and he had to call Jason Martin with the results of the meeting, and he never called Jason Martin. I just had the feeling he didn't really want to be there. He reluctantly agreed to reduce Sunday activity. In the spring of 2014, we still had some drivers practicing on Sunday morning and some events lasting until late at night. Mr. Allen would not answer my calls, even though he said he would like to hear from me or the other community representative at any time if we had a problem. There was also another musical concert and rodeo during the spring of 2014 with loud music and speakers facing the homes, and it also lasted until late at night. One of the other things I wanted to bring up is our frustration with reporting problems related to noise or perceived violations. The planning, when we called the planning manager, he said it was up to the sheriff's department to interpret the noise ordinance. When we called the sheriff's department, they said it was up to the planning manager to interpret the noise ordinance.
Excuse me, Mr. Bowman, your time's up, sir. I'm sorry.
Okay.
It's 3 minutes.
3 minutes.
Okay.
And thank you, sir. And you'll probably have some commissioners respond here shortly when we finish the comments.
All right.
Thank you, sir. Next public speaker is Mr. Tony Cox.
Mr. Bird, I like the way you started out. That's positive. Back in 2006, the Alamance County High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance was adopted to deal with the things that Mr. Bowman is talking about. Rather than deal with the big corporations or the good old boys, misuse and abuse by that ordinance, law, rule, whatever you want to call it, was done against people. Little people that couldn't defend themselves, women that couldn't defend themselves. People like me that couldn't defend myself, not because I couldn't defend what I'd done, but because of the personal attacks. See, I went after the law, the Alamance County High Impact Land Use Ordinance. I didn't go after individuals like they had done me in 2007. I knew it was wrong. In a perfect time, I've said three things. Admission of the wrongdoing that was done during the law being rescinded. The apology. The night that Larry Shambly, when the law was rescinded, and Larry Shambly stood up here and lied. Mr. Boswell called him out. That would have been the perfect time to say, Mr. Cox, we're sorry. But we didn't do it. We stand behind the people. Well, we don't. Some do. Stand behind the people that committed the human rights violations, the constitutional rights violations, the Bill of Rights violations. The racers in this county, they got it going on. You have to wonder why. After the High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance, Ralph Squires out there on McRae Road, it was okay for him. Victory Lane out there on Jug House Road, it was okay for them. Battleground Tire and Record, it was okay for them. And there's others. But some of us suffer. You know, I stopped working for years to prove what I proved. The governor says economic development. Good old boys don't do that economic development. It's all of us. One of the things that I'm good at is economic development, helping other people. And for years I've come down here, and for years I've been attacked, but that's okay. I'm going to continue to do what I do. People say they don't want Sharia law in the United States of America. Others want Christian law. Well, I've seen Christian law. Have a good one.
Thank you, Mr. Cobb. Comments from commissioners?
Well, I'm curious as to what our authority is with respect to Mr. Bowman's issues with the noise and the issues there at the racetrack.
I think there's several ways we can go. I know the sheriff perked up and would like to comment. Sheriff, would you like to comment?
Let me say, in the county, and this has been a problem for some time, we have just a noise ordinance that we can enforce, the noise ordinances. And it's certain periods of time, it's, you know, there's nothing you can do until a certain period of time and then late night, early morning that we can do that. And I would love to see some study done on that because people are being disturbed. I mean, loud music out in the county and stuff, we get calls constantly, over and over. But you know, unless there's certain decibels that are reached and a certain time in the early morning hours or late night hours, there's nothing we can do. I would love to see that visited and looked at by our legal staff because we respond to a ton of calls, and there's not a lot we can do because of the way the ordinance is.
Dan, if I might, yes, I would suggest you come to our planning board meeting this Thursday. We actually have one coming up. I don't know if you met Libby there, but she is now our new planning director.
What time is that?
It will be at 7 o'clock here in this room Thursday night, and bring your issues because it is a land planning issue, what you're talking about, and we make some of the recommendations as that board to the commissioners of dealing with those. So bring in, you have time to speak in open session on that.
And Mr. Chairman, when all the issues came up a couple of years ago, we did try to help try to mediate that issue, and I'll be very honest, I thought it was mediated until now. So I guess over time it's gotten laxer.
Yes.
And so it may be time for the county to step back in and try to mediate again. So we'll work with
right. I think that's where it needs to come through.
Thank you. Any further comments from Mr. Thank you. Approval of the agenda. Do I have a motion on approval of the agenda?
Make a motion to approve.
A second.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Consent agenda. Members, I'd like to pull item number C for discussion, if I may. And with that, any other items to be withheld other than item number C? All right. Not hearing any, do I have a motion to approve the consent agenda with the exception of item C?
I make that motion.
I'll second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Item number C, out-of-state travel request. Ms. Osmond.
Good morning. I have a request before you. Actually, it's a joint request. Impact Alamance, as they move forward in planning for our community with the Cone Foundation, that they the funds from the Cone merger, has been searching for the appropriate strategy and framework to implement their impact into the community. And so they have chosen a program called Strive Together, which is based out of Cincinnati, Ohio. It's in Forsyth County. That's the only other county in North Carolina, in Spartanburg County in South Carolina. And they've brought some folks here, and we've had an opportunity to discuss. The exciting thing about this plan and this framework is it really takes our SAMHSA grant work and is really a next step for cradle to career planning for children, all children in Alamance County. So it's very exciting. So this that you have before you today is a request. Impact Alamance would like to take an Alamance County team of leaders. They will pay part with their foundation. We will pay part with our SAMHSA grant funding. to take a team, and so the request for you have in front of you is for Dan Engel, Craig Honeycutt, Gary Ander, Robin Winthringham that serves on the Social Services Board, Connie Windham, and Susan Osborne. Also attending on Impact Alamance's funds is Leo Lambert, Ed Woodall, Dr. Harrison, Mac Williams from the Chamber, Fairfax Reynolds, Heidi Norwick, Ted Chandler, Derek Steed, and Vernetta Bridges. So it's a large, diverse group. Apologize that I can't fill out all the cost right now because it is by invitation only, and our community is in the process of getting that done. But I do know that the registration's about $595. The airfare will be around $340, and all of this will be funded with no county dollars.
Thank you. Questions from Mr.
Well, I'd like to make a comment. Having served on the Children's Executive Oversight Committee for a few years and becoming knowledgeable about the work of that group and the Alliance for Families and Children, I think this is great. We've invested a lot of time and money, even if it were federal grant money, in developing this conveyor belt of services for our children. You always worry about sustainability, and I think this is going to provide a really good framework and an educational opportunity to help keep that program sustained.
And I'll add along with that that this really will take into this framework the ABSS vision plan and some of the other things that are happening in the community to really begin to format a real framework for serving children and dealing with the poverty issues and the disparity issues and all the positive issues with our children. I had to do a little thing at the Presbyterian Church 2 weeks ago and on poverty, and so I was pulling together some figures, and Alamance County is, I think the state is about 25% for juvenile delinquency rate, and we're 36%. So those are the kinds of social indicators that we want to move with this framework.
Any further questions?
Susan, how much do we have left in our SAMHSA grant?
Do
you know that offhand?
It ends September 30th.
Yeah,
I thought it
was coming to a close.
That is it. But I'm happy to report that the way that has been implemented, it has sustainability already, and this will further that. So we have fund-wise, that was about $1 million for our last year. So, you know, we have the funds to support this, and we will not spend all that we had through September 30th.
I think it's also exciting to hear that some of the leadership, such as Dr. Harrison and Dr. Lambert, going with you to take this in, working as a community.
That's right. It's really a great example of public-private partnership to take this group and go forward and come back with things that we can implement in Alamance County that will make a lifelong difference.
Yep.
Changing lives.
That's right. Being on the partnership, I recognize that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Further comments? Do I hear a motion that we approve?
I'd like to move that we approve the request.
I'll second it.
Right. Motion to second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
Let the record show I did not vote.
Thank you, Ms. Austin.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. I think that goes as an aye, doesn't it?
It goes with the vote.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you, Judge. All right. Next on the agenda is Alamance Burlington School System request to use for bond and lottery proceeds for capital projects. Mr. Jay Fuller. Welcome, sir.
Good morning.
Morning. Good morning, sir.
How y'all doing today?
Good.
Yes, Dave asked me to come up and do the presentation for the bond and the lottery money for the Alamance Burlington Schools. And my understanding that y'all have received all of the paperwork showing exactly what we're going to spend the money on and where it's all going to go. I'm just here to answer any questions you might have concerning what our proposals are.
Thank you, Mr. Fuller. Mr. Honeycutt, would you like to add to that, sir?
It is a request at this time of $341,000. Our understanding, the $800,000 for asbestos work at Williams is not starting at this time. It's on the list to be done, but not starting at this time. So if we look at what is being spent now and what the county has allocated in our current year budget, we'll have about $3 million remaining in lottery funds. But this is not using any of the bond proceeds that we have left. This is just strictly a lottery fund request.
Comments or questions?
Well, a question for Craig. We have those bond proceeds, that's another, what, 2.5 or 2.6 million?
Yes, sir.
That could be used for school facilities?
Yes, sir.
I attended the last ABSS school board meeting.
Yes, sir.
And I guess it was last Monday.
Yes, sir.
And I was a little bit taken back by two speakers that attended there. One, a member of the Turrentine's PTO, and then one who was a student, a superior student at Eastern Alamance, and to hear their descriptions of some of the facilities needs. And I know that we're going to be getting a task force together, and Pam, I'm glad to see you here, and Tony Rose from the school board, to really identify facilities needs, and I hope that happens and we get a plan together soon, because I sense that there's some really serious issues that need to be addressed, and we have some capital dollars to address them. I mean, I don't know that we should spend it all at one time or phase it or how that should work, but I really think it needs to be addressed.
Yes, sir. I went back the next day after that meeting, because I was there too, and went back through and looked at the request that we had had come in from Turrentine School. The last mold issue that came up was 3 years ago. We haven't had any work orders or anything come from the school saying that they had a problem. We sent our new safety officer and our energy lady out the other day and to check some areas that they did finally send a work order in, and we took samples there, and we've sent it to a lab in Cary to get an idea of exactly what was going on down there. And going on to the student at Eastern, we haven't gotten a whole lot of work orders from them saying that they've got roof leaks. I was down there during the Christmas break because my grandson plays basketball, and talked to one of the coaches down there, and he said that they had a problem with some water coming in, but it turned out it was when they turned on the exhaust fan for the gym. If it's raining, some water will come through that one area.
Yeah.
But again, we haven't had any work orders come in from that school requesting that there were. And to add that we've got it on our agenda this summer for the roof and the different classroom buildings to be addressed. And so,
well, I guess that's a matter for the school board to figure out the proper ways to get those things operationalized. But I would ask that we really look at the long range when we decide how we're going to do repairs or facilities management, so that we're not just putting Band-Aids on things only to cost us more money later on.
Yes, sir, we do. We go through and check the work orders that come in. We check and find out what schools have the worst problems with it. Most of the ones that we have roof leaks on are still under warranty, but that's because of the product that was used with Stevens. And Dow Warranty has taken it over, and they've done an outstanding job of coming in and fixing problems we have. But we always look at the schools that we get the most comments from as far as roof leaks and stuff go. And I myself go out and look and see what the problem is, talk to the people, find out what it is. And like I said, I just hadn't been getting that many work orders from schools.
I've got a question on that, maybe to the school board. It looks to me, you know, you're saying you haven't got the work orders from the schools. Would there not be a better proactive way to take facility maintenance and go around and see what's going on in the school?
Yes, sir. We have a roofer contractor that comes in and goes around and looks at the different schools while he's there making a repair for whatever repairs there are. But it's really hard for us. I mean, we can set up a group to go out and look at them.
Right.
But without getting a request from the school, who is right there every day, they're walking the hallways, they should be able to tell me whether I got a roof leak in that building or not.
I guarantee our manager can't tell you where we got a leak up here or not.
Well, I know what you mean. But any requests that come into this,
I don't want to argue with you about it, but I'm just saying, is there a better proactive way to go about figuring out how to address these needs in the
school? Well, that's the reason in our proposal that we have, we've got schools that we're going to go and look at, and Eastern is one of them this summer that's going to have work done to it. And so we compile everything together from our people being out there looking at everything, and then we make up, you know, what we need to do. Which school is the worst? Which one needs the most attention?
Yeah, excuse me one second. Mr. Fuller, I see Dr. Monroe's got his hands up. He wants to be heard.
All right.
Good morning. One proactive way, Mr. Bosman, is what I've done, what I've found out that the workforce have not been submitted, I send emails to them and really make a trip myself. So for the most part, some things happen at that moment, and it's not as though they've been overlooked for a period of time, and they deal with that. And I talked to Mr. Everett about Eastern, and he has that, he knows about that. So his way of dealing with it, and for the most part, you know, Mr. Everett, he's not going to settle on anything anyway. So when I sense, when they inform me that the work order is not submitted at a timely fashion, I deal with that to help be proactive so conditions of the school will be improved, considering that some are very old when they were built.
Right.
So that's one way, and it works. When they're communicated with and told, this is what needs to be done, considering all the other things they have to do, especially in the high school.
I understand. And also with a mold issue, it's usually a prolonged problem that's caused mold. It's not, right. We didn't have a leak and it started mold immediately.
I move approval of this request.
Thank you. Thank you, Judge. I'll second. Any further discussion?
Yeah.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No, thank you, Mr. Fuller.
I do appreciate your time. Thank you.
All right, next item on the agenda is the Nixle Mercy Alert System. Kevin Turner, welcome. And Dave Leonard, Fire Marshal. Kevin, I think you're fairly new with us, I believe, aren't you? Welcome, sir.
Thank you. I've been about 3 months, started October 20th. For those of you that have not had the pleasure of meeting, my name's Kevin Turner. I'm the Emergency Management Planner in Dave's office, in the Office of Emergency Management and Fire Marshal. Appreciate you giving me the chance this morning to let you know about one of our projects. This is our emergency alerting system, as you said. Through use of a third-party system, we've got the ability to alert Alamance County citizens to emergencies, hazards, and other information. We decided to brand this something that would really make it recognizable to Alamance County for citizens and folks that work here. And with a lot of help from Scott, we came up with our logo. We call it ACE Alerts, Alamance County Emergency Alerts. One of the great things about this system is it's extremely simple for our citizens to sign up for. There's several ways. About the easiest is that they can text the word Alamance to 888-777. One of the things that does is allows us to track how many people are signing up through methods that we've put out there to publicize it. They can also visit our website, Alamance-NC Fire Marshal, and go to the Get Alerts link. That'll take them to a sign-up page that'll drop them into the same group as if they were to text it. And again, we can track it. Once we have people signed up, it's a very simple system for us to use to go in and build a message. Once we decide that we need to send a message, within 5 minutes, I can contact all the people that we need to through multiple ways. It'll go out as a text message, an email, voice message if we so desire, a web message. It puts up an expirable link that they can go to and see on the web. It's also going to be linked, or it is linked, to our Facebook, Twitter accounts. And if the message is big enough, it even goes up to Google. And people that are in the area that might not be signed up for the system, as they search for maybe a tornado warning or something like that, they will see it very high on their Google browser. One of the things that we've done with this, after Katrina, one of the things that the federal government saw was there was a real lack of a way to alert people to different plans about storms, response, recovery, things like that. We had all different systems. The warnings that you hear on your TV, EAS, when they're testing those, weather radios and things like that. The federal government came up with IPAWS, Integrated Public Alerts and Warnings. And what that did was it ties all those systems together. And what that means for us is if we have an incident, let's say on the interstate, a major incident, we can send that up through our emergency management channels, and if people above us deem that it's an important enough message, they keep sending it up, and it allows more and more people to be notified of an emergency. Say the interstate is shut down, people that are outside of our system will begin seeing it through wireless emergency alerts that come up on mobile devices such as iPads, phones, and things like that, and the billboards that are on the interstate. It'll go to those. So as people are driving into our area, they know that they might need to avoid a potential situation. Like I mentioned, it does go to our Twitter and our Facebook accounts. Another great thing about our system is it can be location specific. You'll see that example there. We have a couple different ways. I can draw a border around an area so that only those people get that message, or I can put a point right over the location. And if our plans tell us that because of something, a certain radius needs to be evacuated or told to shelter in place, stay in their homes, things like that. It can be very location specific. So if there's an event in, we'll say, Mevin, the folks in Elon aren't getting messages about it. We don't want this system to become something that somebody sees on their caller ID or on their phone and goes, well, that's just another message, I'm going to ignore it.
Is that driven by the device's location at the time, or by where somebody lives when they sign up?
A little bit of both. Mostly it's driven by where they sign up. We attach your zip code with it when you sign up. You're given the opportunity, no matter how you sign up, you're given the opportunity to give us your zip code. So the system knows where you want to know about. And then the iPaul side of things puts it to wireless emergency alerts, which comes, it's an opt-out service, meaning when you buy a new smartphone, it's on your phone unless you turn it off. And as you get close to an area that an alert has been issued for, or if you're affected by an amber or silver alert, it automatically comes to your phone. So that's a little bit of both, but
thank you.
So again, we can be very specific because we don't want people to get numb to this. We want them to pay attention to it because we're not using a lot. It's very emergency driven. Some types of alerts: severe weather, ice storm last year would have been a great example. Days ahead of time, those are the type of things we can get information out to people. These are the shelters that will be open. This is what you need to bring to shelters. Things like that. There you see shelter openings. Storm response and recovery. What efforts are we actually making now that the storm or now that the event has come? What efforts are we as emergency services making to mitigate the effects of that incident, whatever it may be? Like we talked about, things on the interstate, traffic, transportation emergencies, evacuation or shelter in place style alerts, amber and silver alerts. These are more of a law enforcement alert, but they can be what we call rebroadcast right through our system. Currently, we're publicizing it by word of mouth. We've had an article in the Times News that some of you may have seen. Friday afternoon, eight flyers were delivered to Alamance Burlington School Systems offices, and they're working with us. They're going to send it out to all the elementary schools, K through fifth grade, to send home with the students so that it goes out to their parents. Brief little information on what it is and how to sign up. Our health department worked with us and did a fax for us to all the doctors and pharmacists in the county. Just a quick little letter about what it was. The flyer went with it and asked them to put it up in their offices. Working on an email chain to private schools. Been going to a few civic clubs. And we also recently turned this on to another side of the system for Alamance County employees. And one of the great things that does, in the event we have a closing or a delay, we can send that out and say, hey, we got a delay this morning, don't come to work, or the buildings are going to be closed, or this is the schedule we're operating on. A few things we've got planned. A press release is going to go out this afternoon to coincide with this meeting. We're looking at public service announcements, things like in front of the movies, at movie theaters, and things like that. Informational displays at area events and retail centers. We've been in touch with Tanger and Alamance Crossing and Holly Hill to go and set up and just have informational tables for citizens and help them register. And we're continually looking for low-cost and high-impact ways to get this out. One of the things we worked on Friday was a poster to go to all the county buildings where there were public space for it to be displayed. We've got 61,882 unique contacts in the system right now on the public side. Those are citizens. The bulk of those 61,000 of them are landlines, so publicly registered landline in Alamance County that if we decide to send a voice call out, we'll get a phone call. About 500 of those are people that have gone into that specific Alamance group. So through one way of our publicity, they've texted Alamance or they've given us their zip code and gone into that specific group. About another 365 of those are people that have just registered for the system and not been specific to, say, put me in that group. And it's just simply because of the way they registered or when they registered. And then since we released it to the county employees, we've got 455 county employees signed up. So again, that's not the only way they'll be notified of closings and delays. We're still doing the previous methods, but it's just another quicker, more efficient way to get it to them. Any questions?
Any commissioner signed up yet?
I don't know.
I signed up for something. It's been several weeks, I think.
Donation to the board.
But I was thinking I signed up for a similar notification system with the city of Burlington.
Yeah. Burlington does operate Code Red. We encourage anybody that's inside the county of Alamance to register for our system as well, even if they're Burlington citizens or Mebane citizens or Graham citizens.
So they're not going to be somehow coordinated or integrated, these two?
Eventually, we hope so. Yeah. We are looking at ways to do that. So. But for now, those people that register for both, if there is a message that we send out and Burlington sends it out as well, you'll get it too. It's better to be more informed than underinformed, I guess. So.
Further questions? Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you. It's great.
All right. Next, item number 3 of 7, approval to apply for a United Way grant at the library. Ms. Wilkerson.
Good morning.
Morning.
We have before you a request to pursue a grant opportunity with United Way. To part of that grant is requesting 30 iPads that will be used in story times and also over the summers for reading readiness and to help students who are not in school during the summer. They tend to lose a lot of skills, and so those iPads will also be used in the summer to offer reading classes to help students keep up their reading level. We have found that using them in story times helps the story times become less of a passive activity where the parent is just sitting there with their child listening. It helps make it more interactive. And we had an opportunity to pursue this grant, so we wanted to bring it before you all and let you know of the opportunity.
And I understand no matching grants.
No matching grants are required.
Any questions?
Well, I have a question.
Yes, sir.
I always have a question.
That's what you learn.
That's the way you learn. Exactly.
Well, I was reading a letter to the editor, I don't know if it was this morning or over the weekend, very critical of the school systems and their Chrome devices. So this is.
Yeah, I think it was that Sunday. I read that.
So how would you respond to that? Particularly as it pertains to what you're requesting.
I think. Now, refresh my memory about what the criticism of having it
was. Well, I think
it
was just the use of. I think they were. Refer to it as something that's a fad and it's not a necessity, it's a luxury, and they're going to be using these things for
for the libraries, and probably true of the school system as well. There's still a segment of our population that does not have access to technology, and if they have to choose between buying groceries, paying rent, or buying medicine, buying a laptop or a tablet for their child is not on the table. And so one answer to that would be it helps equalize the access. The other thing is that this generation is technology driven, and so if the children don't have access to that technology, then they're going to be further and further and further behind. I also believe very strongly that we as a society are going to be competing in a global competition rather than locally or even nationally. And globally, that's going to be technology driven. And if our students and our children are not taught from an early age and comfortable with the technology, then that puts us behind on a global competition. And there are already studies done that America, the United States, is going to be behind on that in terms of education for other reasons. And I think by not providing access to technology, that's one more barrier to us in that the total world picture.
And I think you showed in your proposal, your grant application, that there's evidence, that there's a body of evidence to show that this has positive outcomes.
Yes. One of the things that we are looking at as we look at our programming, and we're doing a lot of heart and soul searching in the libraries to determine what our role in the community is and how we best serve the community. And we're really looking at literacy and parenting skills. And so we will be directing all of our programming, even our usual story times. In story time now, the parent and the child comes and they sit down and they're read to. And they might get up and sing a song and move around, but it's not really an interactive participation thing, and the parents aren't learning how to model this behavior when they go home. So with the iPads that we'll be using, the kids will be like turning the pages themselves, seeing the pictures interact, talking with their parents about what's going on in the picture. There are apps that you can put the book that the storyteller is reading on the iPad. The child can look at it and talk about it with their parent. So it does make it more interactive, and it does model for parents how to read an actual book, whether it's on an iPad, any kind of tablet, a smartphone, or a book in hand. I mean, just teaching children how to turn the pages, how to read from left to right, from the top of the page down. These are things that we take for granted, but if your parent doesn't know how to read and isn't exposed to reading, they don't know these things either. We assume that all grown-ups do. They don't.
I move approval.
I'd like to just mention one thing on that before we vote on it. I mean, I of course agree with it, but having gone over to Barnes & Noble and read to 5 and 6 year olds out of a book and trying to read upside down and so forth, it would certainly help enhance the experience these children get when you have your story times with them. And I have a 7 year old who comes in my house and said, "Papa, what's the answer to this?" And then she gets her tablet out and asks Google, and she knows before I can tell. So I think that there is a breakdown there because some children don't have the opportunity to do that.
Right, and the parents don't know how to teach it because they don't have it either. So this exactly. is going to help a broad audience.
I think I've seen another hand going up in the back. Mr. Rose, our school board liaison, you'd like to say something about one minute, Mr. Rose?
About Mr. Bird's question with regard to the schools. Mm-hmm. We hear a lot about the textbooks and the cost of textbooks and the money not showing up from the state for textbooks. And a lot of the reasons for that is because much of the textbook content nowadays is delivered via electronic devices. Mm-hmm. Textbooks are very expensive, and you can't update them once you have the book in your hand. To have a book that's $80, $120 per child per book, that's very expensive when you can spend a couple hundred dollars on a device and then the child can have access to a lot of different content that's updated more frequently. We also have, we see a lot of the different teaching pedagogies changing today where the technology allows a lot of things to be done differently. Classrooms, for example, where they put the actual classroom lectures on the devices and the kids watch those at home and then they do the interactive work during the class period is something that has proven to be an improvement in academic achievement. And so without the devices, we miss out on those types of things. So I would respond in that way to that.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
And it addresses a lot of different learning styles, so that whether if you learn just by reading or if you learn by touch and doing, the electronic device addresses all of that.
Thank you, ma'am. We do have a motion on the floor.
And I'll second that.
We have a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Ms. Whitley.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. All right. Item number 47, resolution restoring the allocation of lottery funds. Members, if you had the opportunity to read the resolution, this is one of the top priorities by the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. Statutorily, there's supposed to be 40% minimum of the proceeds, of the net proceeds, coming to the counties, and it's down to what, Mr. Honeycutt, about 26%?
Yes, sir. Between 20 and 27%.
20 and 27, and I would like to make a motion that we send this resolution out, that we approve this resolution, send it out to the other 100 counties. And I'll ask this time, is any further comments from any other?
This came up the school, up at the school board meeting last week, too, and I think that the school board will be adopting, hopefully, a similar resolution.
Okay. So. Yes.
I do have a motion.
Is it seconded?
No,
second?
Go ahead.
I'll second it.
All right. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All right. Thank you. The next is item number 5 of 7, 1304, resolution in support of the jail food bill. County Attorney Albright, and I think the sheriff, both of you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Whichever one wants to speak.
Sheriff's very courteous this morning.
I saw the finger for me to get up here, so. This is a resolution that arises out of a contract we have with a local vendor who provides a food allocation service for us. He works with a nutritionist, and he has to provide meal costs for the sheriff at a cost not to exceed $1.38 per meal. Now, that's an average cost. The nutritionist works with the requirements of the, there's a law that requires how much calories an inmate is supposed to receive a day. And he can achieve that by having all of his proteins and milk products in the morning or at lunch or in the evening. In any event, the nutritionist comes up with that plan. The contract with the local food vendor allows him to make the decision whether to buy apples for his fruits or oranges for his fruits, whether to get his proteins from eggs or from hamburger, not steak, hamburger. And the goal is to keep the cost down as low as possible. The sheriff's hotel over there, inmates fluctuate depending on whether a judge has a bad Friday. As you know, Judge, a lot of people get put in jail on Fridays for not paying their child support. So the sheriff may be faced with another 20, 30 people that he has to feed for the next 10 to 15 or 20 days. In reviewing and working on this contract with the sheriff, we looked at the local school board law, and there is a law that allows the school system an exemption. So they have great flexibility in purchasing their food. Their needs differ from the sheriff in that most school cafeterias know how many children are going to eat every day, unlike the sheriff. So what this does, it is a contract that puts all of the risk on the local food vendor, who is about 3 blocks from the jail. And if they have a sudden influx of prisoners, they can call him. He has the storage capacity to keep food ready to be delivered. He also has the capacity to buy in bulk, which lowers his cost, which makes this possible. And I think the sheriff can give you some more details on how much he has saved, but under the old contracts with the canteen service, the average cost per day was $1.42 per meal. So he has dropped that, I think it's about $1.13 per meal, using the vendor, the local vendor here. The purpose of the law, the change in the bill that I prepared and ask you to support with your resolution, is to give the sheriff the same flexibility the school system has so that he can further reduce his cost as needed.
Any questions?
Well, I had a couple of questions again. So what concerns me is we're changing really a policy by having this legislative action take place, in a sense, because right now the statutes require that these kinds of contracts be bid out.
No, not this contract. This is a service contract. Okay. It's like a contract with a lawyer or an architect or another professional. The food broker is the one that makes the decision with the nutritionist as to what to buy.
Okay.
He can buy in bulk when apples are in season. He can buy them locally. And he puts them in his facility over there and stores them. If he gets a good deal on oranges, he can buy those. If he has a good deal on eggs, stock up on eggs. So he is providing a service. He is making those decisions, not the sheriff.
Well, the reason I brought up the law is because I thought that the resolution stated that it's a resolution of support for North Carolina House Bill amending the provisions of GS 143-129 and GS 143-131, right, exempting jail food purchases.
That's right.
So, but
that's
you're right, saying that those, so if the statutes sheriff, don't really apply in this case anyways, because it's more of a service contract.
Well, in this particular contract, they don't apply. But okay, if the sheriff went out and wanted to buy orange futures,
they would have to bid
then it would. Okay. He'd have to bid it out, betting on whether they're going to have a good orange crop or not. But he and I don't have that capacity.
Well, I appreciate what's in the contract. And when I was at the jail the other day, I noticed that it's pretty crowded, and there's no room to be storing 12 days worth of food in refrigerators over there. And I like the concept of keeping our business local and supporting our local farmers, which apparently this food service does.
Yes, does.
There's a big movement in our community to do just that thing, and to the extent we're using more fresh fruits and vegetables for our inmates, that's a healthier diet anyway. So
I think the sheriff will tell you that a well-fed inmate is a happy inmate, and a happy inmate's not going to lash out and hurt a guard. Which will cost us.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Alamance. Sure, if you'd like to say a few words.
Yeah. Certainly, there's a lot of things that come into play, and I really appreciate Commissioner Byrd coming over last week and taking a tour of the jail. There's a lot of reasons that we wanted to contract with a local company. First of all, this particular company is less than a mile away from the Alamance County Jail. The individual is a service contract more so than a food contract, in that he has purchased two large freezers that holds a supply of food for the Alamance County Detention Center. Federal standards, and we keep federal inmates, say that we're supposed to have enough food for 22 days in case an emergency or something happens. When the Alamance County Detention Center was planned, they did not take into consideration initially the kitchen and storage of food services. We went from 156 beds to 476 beds, which was a substantial increase, not being able to increase the kitchen where it should be and the storage facilities for the food. And that was a problem initially. We had to bring in a mobile kitchen for a while until they knocked out a wall to be able to add some. Also, by dealing with this particular company, we're able to, when the pork prices, it is its lowest level, or beef prices, or milk, or bread, we're able to purchase a substantial amount and save money, as you would see compared to the company that we were with. We also work, they have a nutritionist that works with us to develop our menu. A lot of things that people don't take in consideration in the jail is also, we have a different group of individuals. We have religious sects that we have to provide certain meals for, which is a problem unless you can order and get those foods. And many times on Friday, our capacity, jail capacity, may go from 450 to 525 and 530 simply because the judges have issued weekend sentences for these individuals. And, it, you know, when we don't have so much food and we're having to wait with a company we were contracting with in Raleigh for a day or two to get the food there, when we can make a phone call within the hour, boom, it's at the jail. It's just a whole lot simpler. Secondly, it is good to be able to deal locally simply because we are saving money, and these tax-paying corporations in Alamance County is getting their money back somewhat. Not to mention that the company we were dealing with was $1.42 per meal, and we have done figuring with the company we are contracting with $1.13 per meal. That's quite a saving when you're looking at it. Three meals a day, 550 inmates a day. That's a substantial saving for the counties and folks. If I can, as sheriff, I'm going to try to save the taxpayers' money, because you guys and girls are looking at me when it comes to budget time and trying to save money.
So I went online and...
Yeah, you taught me that.
I did go online and looked up Steve's Market, right? That we
Steve's Garden Fresh Market.
And in rave reviews, I think I need to pay a visit myself.
We got good reviews.
So I was curious, if are there other vendors like Steve's that would be eligible or qualified to bid or to contract with the
probably not in the county to provide substantial. I mean, he bought two huge freezers to provide the service of
right.
being able to hold the number of days in advance that the federal guidelines require, state guidelines.
So and then one final question. If we do this and the laws change, the state legislature passes the law, will we, and Clyde, I guess this would be for you, are we still going to provide the legal review of the contracts? You know, when I went to the commissioner's training program, Eddie and I were down to Chapel Hill a week before last, and learned a lot about ethics and procurement and everything. But one of the things I learned is that as a governing body, we don't have any power other than what the legislature says that we have. So we can't do something just because there's not a statute that says we can't. We can only do things because there's in the legislation language that says we can do something. So if these statutes no longer apply in this situation, are we able to still, you know, have some monitoring through yourself, signing off like you did on the current contract?
Yes, every contract this county has comes through my office.
Yeah. And I will say this, the sheriff monitors every bill coming into that sheriff's office. And I think Chief Brett will tell you, I raise cane when I see the bill go up, you know, from what it is, and we do some checking. I feel like that's my responsibility.
Move approval, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Judge. Once we finish, just a few more brief comments. Looking at the contract, it's a very thorough contract in looking at it. And it is not unusual for counties to ask for local bills that fit their needs. And they have an outstanding staff down in Raleigh that you know that goes over those things in terms of the legal definitions of the law and whether we can do it or not. So it's been issued. The bill's been issued. The local delegation, if we approve it today, supports it. And we'll move from there in the General Assembly and see how it comes out. Sure. Thank you. I have a motion on the floor. Do I have a second?
Mr. Chairman, if I could also just reiterate that,
yes,
that it's not an open-ended contract. There is a deadline or there's a end date on the contract. If the costs do get out of hand and escalate beyond, we have that option to relook at it, to bid it, to look at other vendors. So we're not married to one vendor.
Yeah.
But we do have the options. And this just gives us a little bit of flexibility.
So really what we're voting on is a resolution.
Yes, sir.
Here,
yes,
to
resolution.
Ask,
yes, sir.
Dennis to introduce this into,
yes,
the General Assembly.
Just a resolution.
Just to clarify.
Motion
that
on the floor. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. All right. Moving on to the budget amendments. Health Department, Ms. Saunders.
Good morning.
Morning.
have in front of you a budget amendment for the Alamance County Children's Dental Clinic. The Health Department received notification that the Children's Dental Clinic received an award of $3,500 from the Delta Dental Foundation. This foundation funding does not require a match, and the funding will be used to go toward the purchase of dental equipment, particularly the Panorex X-ray machine, which is much needed.
All right.
Questions?
Do I hear a motion?
I move that we approve.
Second.
All right. Motion is second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you, Ms. Sonner.
Thank you.
County Manager's Report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It was mentioned earlier about the law enforcement recognition activity that was held Saturday morning, and I do want to thank the board members who did attend. I also want to thank Richard Hill, who helped, and the maintenance department who helped with the setup, and Brian, and members of the Alamance County Sheriff's Department. I also want to thank Reverend Don Carter and Reverend David Carter from Baptist Temple Church, who really kind of organized that. It was a very, very nice event, and we appreciate the opportunity to be glad to host that in the criminal court's parking lot. So we did want to thank everybody for the help on that. Also on Saturday, as was mentioned earlier, we do want to thank the life of Barry Bass and what he meant to Alamance County, and it was a very touching funeral that was held. We had the opportunity to help with the reception over at the Youth Services Building. Again, maintenance helped set up. We also had Lisa Dodson was able to rearrange some of her scheduling, but the Health Department and their staff did a wonderful job, and just want to thank them for their willingness to go above and beyond and remember Barry's family during this time. And again, we thank you for your support of that as well. And Barry will be sorely missed within this community. We hated to see him retire, and but we appreciate what he did for us. So the other couple of things I do want to mention. I think there'll be discussion of the Joint Facilities Committee that'll between us and the school board. And when we have those members set, we will try to set up a meeting as soon as possible. So we'll try to get Dr. Harrison this week. I do want to mention tomorrow morning at 8 a.m. at the Family Justice Center, there is a request as a joint meeting between Alamance County and the municipalities, the elected officials, really just to go and see what the Family Justice Center does, meet their board, and to get this board engaged back in what the Family Justice Center is doing. But that's tomorrow morning, 8 a.m. at the Family Justice Center in the basement. And one other meeting, the Hallfields Economic Development Zone meeting. We do finally have a date for that, which will be... oh my gosh, I didn't write the date down. I have the time. It is the 19th. It is the 19th at 4 o'clock at ACC in room A238 and A239.
And that's with the Mevin and...
Mevin and Graham also, yes, sir.
Joint meeting.
Just an update on activities and go over the petitions from the property owners to see who has agreed to be within the economic development zone. But one of the things we're going to talk about is next steps and maybe looking at how we fund it becoming a certified industrial site with the state and looking at those options.
Have anything to do with the... new business that one of the newspapers talked about?
No, sir. Not at this time. And that's all I have.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Commissioner's comments.
I have a question about the health insurance committee. I thought the health insurance committee was supposed to meet some time. I haven't heard anything pertaining to it. Where do we stand on it? We've only got less than 5 months now.
We were in the process of doing the request for proposals. Where have we sent? Have they been?
The draft has been completed.
Right.
We just need to meet one more time before we send the draft out.
Okay. We'll try to meet this week. And we'll, whatever's good for you, you let us know.
All right. Thank you. Judge, anything else?
Nothing.
All right. Any others? All right. A couple things. This the ad hoc facilities task force that Mr. Honeycutt mentioned, I'd like to bring three names before the board in terms of the citizens that to sit on this committee. This is my respectful request that John Paisley, who has a keen interest in the facilities with the school system and also with the county facilities and some very good ideas, that he be one of the members on that committee. And also Albert Freeman, who is a licensed electrical contractor, owns a business in Elon, be the other. He'd bring a wealth of information to that committee. I'd like for them to be our two primary citizens on that committee. And I'd also like to have an alternate that sits on the committee in the event that this is going to be pretty busy committee, but in the event that you can't be there, John, or Albert can't, Sammy Moser, who is a very good citizen that really has a keen interest in the welfare of this county and government, and has expressed an interest. And Sammy and I had the opportunity to work together on some coastal fishing bills when I was in the General Assembly. So those are the three I'd respectfully recommend to this board to approve, and just openly without voting on it, if you just give me the go ahead and say that looks good for this annual committee.
I'm fine with that.
All right, thank you. And I'd just like to reiterate the commissioners and thank you, men, for serving. Thank you for that. And then great day Saturday, Sheriff. There would have been a slew more people there if it hadn't been 27 degrees for the law enforcement program. And I do just publicly thank both pastors for their work on that, and it was a great event.
And also having our congressman there too.
Yes, Congressman Walker was there also, in the cold. So thank all those that had the opportunity to attend. I know some there was some sickness that some couldn't be there, but thank you. Any further comments from the commissioners? If not, it's 10:06 and meeting is adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.